Good evening to all of you. So I'm happy to share some of my knowledge that I have on Odonis today with you all. The main objective of today's session is to create more interest among people about Odonis. The topic says that it's Dragonflies of India, but I am not really going to cover each and every like region-wise diversity of India. I'm not an expert on taxonomy of Odonids, but yes, I will definitely try to show you some of the interesting and discuss some of the interesting facts, their habits of their different life stages, so that when you go on field next time, you look more for Odonids and get more observations and share with all of us. Okay, so let's start. Just let me know if I'm not audible. Okay. So Professor Madhav Gadge, he is one of the finest ecologists that India has, and he has very precisely, very effectively summed it up, the characteristics of a dragonfly, in this short poem. He says he says strong by winds and goddamn sly. It's a very, when you look at a dragonfly, it's very stout. It's very, the built up is very strong, as you can see. Then it's very clever. And then he says that it, he talks about a life cycle also, that born out of water and takes to sky. That is a semi-aquatic insect. We'll talk more about that. And one last important characteristic that he talks about is the foremost of animals that to fly. So yeah, as you can see over here, this during the, if you see the evolutionary time scale, there were insects before Odonids came into existence, but they were not able to fly. I mean, they were not able to conquer the aerial mode of life. So dragonflies and damselflies were the first insects to conquer this aerial mode of life, and they are called as masters of aerodynamics. They're the first, very first insects that were able to fly. And so when they evolved, so around 3 to 350 million years ago, when it was a Carboniferous era, Carboniferous period. So that time when the earth was, there were a lot of swamp and a lot of marshes around. And the earth was dominated by, mostly by ferns, the gymnosperms. These big size, very large size dragonflies, actually they roamed around the earth. And as you can see over here in this graph, if you compare the size of a dragonfly to a man, then it was the wingspan of this species, the Meganeura species, it almost was 65 to 70 centimeters, and that's a huge ordinate. So along the time, they say that as per the oxygen in the air decreased, so the size of the insect started decreasing. So during the earlier time, during Carboniferous time, actually the life forms were big in size, and later the size of these creatures slowed down due to many various factors. So this is the cast of a fossilized Meganeura species that is shown over here. Just a second. Yeah, this one. So what we see, the dragonflies or damselflies we see today are like the distant relatives of this Meganeura, we may say. Yeah, so just to give you a brief background, unlike some insects like butterflies then beetles, dragonflies and damselflies are like the insects with incomplete metamorphosis. That is, they don't have this resting stage. This pupal stage that we get to see in most the Lepidopterans and then some of the beetles and some other insects also, but they are having incomplete life cycles. So what are the life stages of this incomplete metamorphosis? That is, the first and foremost is the eggs, and then out of the egg the larva hatches. So there are many terms actually. Larva, you can call them the nymph also. Basically, it's a miniature form of the adult, and the adult kind of looks like the nymph, and the adult kind of look similar, but there are no fully developed wings in case of nymphs or the larvae. So these are called as the nymphs. So here in this beautiful illustration, you can see over here the eggs. They are a major part of their life cycle is spent under the water in the larval stage. As you can see over here, the eggs are when they are inside the water or aquatic environment, they are different instars of their larvae. That means they molt into, they grow. As they eat, they grow and molt into different stages of the nymph itself. They're called as instars. And when the final instar is ready to emerge, it comes out of the water and then the wings are fully developed in that stage, and that's the adult we call. And the color patterns are completely different than in the nymphal or larval stage. So this is how the larvae of dragonflies or damselflies look. This is the larva of a dragonfly, Pantala flavescens or wandering glider. These are actually seasonal pool breeders insects. So you can see over here, the difference between these two nymphs or larvae is that one prominent feature is that these are caudal gills, and those are absent case of dragonfly larvae. There are no caudal gills visible outside their body. And these are actually the respiratory organs through which the larvae respirate. And in this case, in the case of dragonfly larvae, it's a jet propulsion mechanism, and also there are tracheas to take the air in, and that's how they breathe. And they're quite robust as compared to the damselfly larvae. Yeah, moving on to their habitats. So it's very crucial and very essential part of their life, we can say. And they occupy various types of habitats. And why they are very crucial? Because this is the habitat, or in some cases there are these microhabitats that they inhabit. So they might be the ones which are static, like these ones, the marshlands or the lakes or small ponds or the paddy fields also. Sometimes in case of some seasonal pool breeders. And there are some specialists which are restricted to the hill streams. Those are perennial, or mostly in case of the specialists are restricted to the semi-evergreen or evergreen forest. And some of them are really fond of, you know, shady areas. So this is with the streams with close canopy. So that is the kind of habitat that they prefer. And this is the kind of also differentiation in their niche, as we can see over here, and how their habits are adapted or evolved according to the habitat that we will see soon. Okay, so this is the kind of microhabitat that I was talking about. So there is this term phytotelma. So basically the rainwater that gets collected into the tree hole, that forms a small microhabitat for some insect to complete their life cycle. In India, there is one species like tricolor that completes its life cycle. The larvae basically it uses this kind of microhabitat, this one, and like these ones. They use this kind of microhabitat to complete their life cycles. And Subramaniam sir actually day before yesterday also mentioned about these habitats. And dragonflies or damselflies are not the only ones to occupy these microhabitats, but there are other invertebrates also. Like in this case, there's one small crab over here, you can see. So yeah, such microhabitats and habitats are really crucial for them, because that's how they are adapted. So they have these behavioral adaptations to them and structural adaptations to them associated as well. So depending upon their habit, they are grouped into some types. As you can see over here, in case of the damselflies, this over here, they are called as claspers. So for damselflies, what happens is the females insert their eggs into the plant tissue, and the larvae that come out of the egg, they need something to clasp or hang on. So they are called as claspers. So that's why aquatic vegetation is very much essential in their life. In case of damselflies. So most of the claspers are of damselflies. In some cases, they are also of the dragonfly group that are codanas. What are codanas? We will see. Then there is another type, those are sprawlers, which, you know, they kind of crawl onto the lower atom of aquatic habitat. And they are very fast, they are very agile, and they are very sensitive to the touch. So if they are disturbed, they quickly will escape underneath a rock or into the aquatic vegetation itself. They are called as sprawler, and examples are wandering glider and some other skimmer species. Then there are some larvae which kind of hide themselves into the aquatic environment, or whatever the silt or mud is getting deposited at the bottom, they hide in that environment.
Nehad, I think there's a problem with the audio. Hello? Nehad, can you hear me? So there's a button in between. We can't hear you. Hello, Neha. Hello. Neha, can you remove your this thing and speak?
Hello, can you hear me now?
I think, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, now it's better.
Oh. Let me share the screen, yeah. So yes, as we were talking about the habit of the larvae, some of them are hiders. As you can see, the Brachythemis larva, the ditch jewel larva. So these larvae have setae, small hair-like structure on their body, so that the mud gets deposited on their body and they can very well, you know, get camouflaged into the surrounding environment. As you can see over here, there are the eyes, and this is the posterior part of their body. So any prey, any small fish or zooplankton comes, passes their way or their passage, they just seize that prey. And the larvae are very ferocious in nature, so they can eat whatever they can hold on to. Starting from small zooplankton, Chironomus larvae of different insects, and also other larvae of dragonflies or damselflies also. So yeah, they are very ferocious, and in this environment also they are one of the crucial predators in that food chain also. The last type is of the burrower. So these are mostly the gomphid or the clubtails larvae show this kind of a habit. And generally they prefer the substratum that is made up of the gravel or soft soil or small stones, as you can see. So their color is also very much matching to the surrounding environment. And they kind of, if any danger is over there, so they kind of burrow into the loose soil. We will hopefully get to see the video of habit of such larva at the end. Moving on. Yeah, so this is the complete picture of the parakeet darner, as we can see over here. This is the larva. This is the final instar. When the final instar, when it is, the adult is ready to emerge, it crawls out of the water and it hangs on to some stick or something, and then the adult dragonfly emerges. It spreads out its wings, it dries itself, and then it's ready to go. So the time of emergence for many species vary a lot. I have seen some skimmers, probably Pantala, so wandering glider larvae, they emerge they were emerging during the evening time, 8 or 9 p.m. or something like that. Then there are some larvae which cling on to the substratum or the surrounding vegetation during the night, and maybe at the morning time they emerge, so that with the warmth of the sun they can dry their wings very nicely, and then they can fly out. Okay, so there are three suborders of Odonata. So Odonata, why Odonata is because they have this teeth-like structure in their jaws. That's why this order is called as Odonata. And in that we have three suborders. So many of you might be familiar with this classification but for the beginners or the ones who are joined newly, for them this slide is there. So these figures are mostly change about the species number. So 276 species of dragonflies and the rest number. So if you add this up, this mostly sums up to 487 species. But right now, there's a lot of species, new species have been added to this number. And right now we have around 495 species of odonates in India that we get to see. So this particular order, dragon damselflies, were a combination of both Anisoptera and the Zygoptera. These both two, is because they show combined characters or both the characters. The body is very stout and the eyes are very big, separated. So that's why this order is a different one. And in India, we only have one species. One representative species of one family, and that was also described based on the larva. It is known to, it is recorded from the Darjeeling part of West Bengal, and the adult is, I don't think so, adult is seen by not many people. So we will mostly talk about the other two suborders, the Anisoptera and the Zygoptera, that is dragonflies and damselflies. So the dragonflies comprise a larger number of species, 276 species, and damselflies compared to that have more families but less number of species, but high endemism in case of damselflies as compared to dragonflies in India. Okay, so basic differentiation between dragonflies and damselflies, just by looking at them you can make out that the dragonflies are very strongly, or the bill is very strong, stout. These are kind of delicate and these are weak flyers. So if you go to their body parts, these wings are of not equal size and shape. That's why the term is their Anisoptera. And the wings in case of damselflies of similar size and shape, that's why that is called as Zygoptera. And the eyes of the dragonflies are either jointed at one point or they are kind of fused entirely. But in case of damselflies, there is a distance, so they are separated apart, you can say. Okay, so here maybe we can see more, nicely. This is a species, Crimson Marsh Glider, Trithemis aurora. You can see how the eyes are jointed at one point. In case of gomphids, there is a separation. But not as wide as in case of damselflies. Okay, so I'm sorry for this photo, the quality is not that good, but I think you can make out how the eyes look. So here you can see. Okay, so when we will move ahead, I think we will have to understand these some of the terms. These are very important. So we'll just quickly go through there how the body parts are named and all. So any insects are differentiated into head, thorax, and abdomen. In case of odonates, there are 10 segments of abdomen. Thorax is the middle part to which both the pairs of wings are attached, and the head is there. We talked about it. And at the last segment of the abdomen, that is the 10th segment, you get this anal appendages over here. So this structure, so this I have cropped it and zoomed it over here. In case of damselflies, so there are superior and inferior appendages. The superior ones over here are really small. This is a yellow bush dart species, and the inferior, the lower ones are quite long. In case of dragonflies, mostly the superior ones, you can see there are two, and the lower one, the inferior one, is kind of a spoon shaped or a fused one. Yeah. And then if it's a male, it will have a secondary genitalia. So over here on the ventral side of the second segment, you will see there is a small kind of protuberance. So that's where the secondary genitalia or the male genitalia are situated. And of course, the females lack them. So this is not there. So if you want to just quickly identify, just quickly want to see in the field if the specimen is a male or female, because colors are very decisive sometimes in the field. So you can go for this character. Yeah. Yeah. So moving on to some of the representatives of some of the families. So largest family is the Libellulidae. They're called as marsh hawks, skimmers, gliders. They're different names. And as in case of butterflies also, the common names depict they indicate their habit or indicate their body structure sometimes, as over here. This is a long leg marsh glider, because if you see the legs of other dragonflies, these are kind of longer. So this is a long leg marsh glider. This one over here, ground skimmer, is basically, it's a very common species, and you can easily see it in urban landscapes near a pond or any near the nala also. In your garden also it can come. So it's a commonest dragonfly. Then slightly towards the fringes of the urban landscape, where there is a paddy fields or something like that, then you'll get to see these other two species. The streams, if they are there, crimson marsh glider and yellow-tailed ashy skimmer. So likewise, there are other species of skimmers. And because of these cloud-like pattern on the wings, this is a male, of course. So the males are more colorful, as in nature, in case of birds also that we see, males are more colorful, males are having more characters. So this is a male of coral-tailed cloud wing, which is mostly active during the evening times. The male has this bluish colored cloud like roundish patches on its wings. This is another common dragonfly of the urban landscapes. This is called as granite ghost. As you can see, the name itself, self-explanatory, like very well matches to the background. This one over here, the black stream glider. Mostly this is found along the streams. And this one, the green marsh hawk, one of the very ferocious dragonfly. And it can catch up and hold on the other larger species also. I've seen green marsh hawk preying on the biggest species also. Yeah. So moving on to another family, that is clubtails or gomphids. One of the trickiest dragonflies, I would say. The taxonomy is very, it's difficult as compared to the libellulids, because these dragonflies are, as you can see, the large size. They're very quick. They inhabit canopy, most of the times the tree canopy part. That's their habitat. So it's not very easy to spot them or to, take photographs or catch them. So this is a common club tail. So this can be relatively easily can be seen around the ponds and the lakes, but not the many members of the Gomphidae family. This is also a comparatively common species, common hoop tail. I don't know if you can see, but I'll just zoom this part. So the 10th segment we talked about. So the anal appendages are hook-shaped. Or a hook-like, that's what is called as hook tail. Yeah. Moving on to the next family, these are darners or ash nymphs. And please see over here, the eyes are largely, touching each other, or they are kind of fused together. So that's very characteristics of darners. Comparatively common species, the blue darner. This is the male of Anax indicus, the lesser green emperor. This is also very active during the evening hours. So further we come to damselflies. So this family comprises of one of the smallest damselflies of India. So this is the pygmy dartlet, and there are various color forms in this species in case of females. So it can take this red morph. It can, so there is a heteromorph also that looks like the male. So there are various color forms of this species, very tiny damselflies. Similarly, we have over a golden dartlet, beautiful golden color on the abdomen. And many of the Pseudacinian species are also a part of this family. One representative is this three-lined dart. So basically, maybe this male was just emerged or something, because the colors are not that prominent in this case. There are other families also, like this one, the bamboo tails, and this beautiful Chlorocyphidae members are one of the very beautiful damselflies. You can see this iridescent color patches on their wings. The males, of course, they have it. And over here, the males has this black patch. Again, these kind of inhabit the streams, open canopy streams also, the kind of habitat they inhabit. And stream rubies are mostly found in wood, like semi-evergreen or evergreen forest. With basically the forest where the rainfall is higher, or the habitat where the rainfall is higher, and close canopy streams are there. So such forest patches they prefer. Then there are some beautiful another damselflies having this iridescent green colors. There are three species in India of this rubies. This one is a stream glory, male again. Then we have a clear wing forest glory and a black tip forest glory. So the clear wing will not have this iridescent green color on its wings, and the black tip forest glory will have the black color patch on its wingtip. So that's the Calopterygidae family. And this is an exception to damselflies. We say that, so generally if you see, the dragonflies will keep their wings open when they're resting, and they never close it and hold it back on their bodies. But the damselflies do that. But in case of spread wings, the Lestidae family, like the one you can see, they kind of, they have this habit of spreading their wings while they're resting. That's why they're called as spread wings. Then we have some specialist or special gems, we can call them. Again, a very beautiful male of having iridescent blue patches on its body, the Myristica sapphire. And this one over here is called as ruby-tailed hawklet. You can see this, why they're called as ruby-tailed. The dark red color is there. So yeah, these are actually the gems of our biodiversity. Or the world of Odonata, we can say. So these are specialists of the Myristica forest. The other day also, Subhu sir mentioned about Myristica forests. So these are specialized, you know, it's a special habitat in which Myristica plants are there. And both these species, so the ruby-tailed hawklet, basically it breeds in the swamps associated with these Myristica forests. And this one, the Myristica sapphire, it will breed in the rivers or the streams that are flowing in through the through these forests. So these are some of the specialists that we have. And this one, Myristica, the ruby-tailed hawklet. Till now, it is only recorded from Kerala, then if I'm not wrong, from Karnataka, and recently it has been also recorded from Angoli. So basically, as we go on recording more about these data deficient species, we will get to see more about their distribution. So till now it was, you know, it was considered kind of a rare dragonfly, but once it was spotted, then many observers started following that, and slowly these observations came up from different parts of the country. So that's how we can say the citizen science works. Yeah. So coming to some of the habits of odonates, these are called as the masters of aerodynamics. As you can see, these are the These are called by different names, called as gliders, we know them by the names of helicopters, very famous name from our childhood memories. And they're also called as sky hunters. So basically why is because they have this amazing flight ability. So if you see these wings, each of the four wing has the ability to move independently. So it's not the same as in case of butterflies or other insects. If you see the wings of butterflies or something, they are coupled when they are flying. So the four wings and the hind wing on one part on the right side and the other part, they climb kind of coupled together, and then the insect takes off, or then the insect is able to fly. But the special ability of moving each wing independently gives it the agility, we can say, so that the damselfly or the dragonfly is able to glide. It can hover. It can take turns while it is flying in the midair, and then it can also fly backwards. So there are many advantages due to this this kind of flying adaptation that they have, which is unlike and which is unique to this group and not found in other insects. So these are the masters of skies. Then, very elaborate part of, very crucial part of their life cycle is the breeding cycle and the breeding biology. So this is very complex. This involves multiple things, like male defining its territory, guarding its territory. Till the oviposition is over, it's a complete, very nice phenomenon where you can see various processes from the evolutionary point of view, or just you can see and watch them, how do they maintain their territory and all that. So over here you can see, if there is a water body, and you can see this is a typical scene. At the potential oviposition sites, or the sites which have more preference towards for the females to lay eggs. So the males will try to hold that area, that is their territory, and they will try to defend it. And they will often engage into such combats where the male will chase away the other rival male from entering its territory. Because if he is guarding the most preferred oviposition sites for the female, obviously the chances for that male to mate is that gets increased. So it will defend its territory, and once it's there, it will perch on some substratum and show off its colors. So why such colors, why such different beautiful colors and patterns on their wings is also has this evolutionary background. So they display their colors, and females, though the receptive females, though they're passing through the territory, they will also check for the oviposition site or a particular territory that a particular male is holding. And if the female is receptive, it's a permutation and combination of various factors. So that female also checks the water flow, and if it's a sunny or a shady area, depending on various species, they have such preferences. So once the female is receptive, the tandem linkage forms. So the male kind of holds the female. In case of dragonflies, they hold a female by from the back of their head, as you can see. In case of damselfly, the male holds a female by the prothorax. We'll see some more pictures ahead. Yeah. So over here, you can see it nicely. It is holding, the male dragonfly is holding the female from the back of the head. And in case of damselflies, it looks like it's holding by its neck. So it's, the anal appendages, the structure, the shape of anal appendages is very much, it's very important. It's kind of a lock and key mechanism. So it's very specific to particular species, and that's why whenever a new species is getting described, they describe all the structure of the anal appendages and all. So because that's a very prominent character. So the tandem linkage is formed. This is kind of a wheel, and a heart wheel also, they say. That's why also these insects are unique, and this heart-shaped structure is unique to them when they form it. Okay, so the next step of in the oviposition, breeding cycle is laying the egg. So once the copulation is over, the female will go to that particular ovulation site. It will lay eggs. So that is done in different ways again. So in case of most of the dragonflies, it will just release the bunch of the eggs into the water. And male will keep a guard. It will be nearby hovering, or it will sit on nearby and will keep on guarding, because there is another phenomenon called as male rivalry in case of oronids. So because if the female is left unattended, the chances are that the other rival males can come. They can get hold of the female. They can remove the sperm package of the earlier male and deposit of their own. So such kind of, and that is just waste of the time and energy of this male. So till the time the oviposition is over or the egg laying over is over, it has to guard the female. Most of the cases, the female is attended by the male or guarded by the male. But there are some cases in which if the female chooses a spot where there is, you know, less activity of males or something. So sometimes it also happens that it will lay the eggs independently without the guarding of the male. So most of the dragonflies they oviposit exophytically, just above the water. They dip their abdomen into the water, release the eggs. But there are some, again, exceptions in case of darners. So they do not oviposit exophytically, but they insert their eggs into the plant tissue. That process is called as endophytic, which is shown by damselflies, and which is very much unique to damselflies. So because they need aquatic vegetation for this process. So here you can see the oviposition can happen in, again, two different ways. When the male is in contact with the female, that is called as contact guarding. And this one is non-contact guarding. When the male is not in physical contact with the female while she is laying the eggs. So both the processes have their own disadvantages and advantages. So in this case, if the male detects any predator, or if there is too much of a disturbance, then it can quickly get hold of the female and fly away with it to another spot. So that's the advantage over here. And so in this case, over here, the female can really, you know, go inside the water also sometimes and lay the eggs to, you know, ensure the survival of the eggs. So that's the advantage that that they get in this process. Male will still be guarding her over here. So this picture is actually from the second Dragonfly India meet in Thattikad. So we observe this phenomenon of yellow striped bush dart, that is Sudagrian indicum, that is again an endemic species from Western Ghats. So we observe this phenomenon, and the female was underwater for about like 16 minutes from the time we counted. And we had to leave in between. So more than 16 minutes it was underwater and it was laying the eggs while the male was keeping a guard by hovering above. So this is kind of non-contact guarding. Yeah. So this is amazing phenomenon. And then after this male, so once the oviposition is over, the male leaves the female, goes to its original oviposition site, and keeps on a guard on its territory. And then again mates with another female. And the female, if it is having, maybe it will take a break or it will relax. If it has the batch of unfertilized eggs again, it will come again to the oviposition site and it will mate with another male. And that's how the cycle goes on. Yeah, so quite interesting. And one more interesting part is the migration of the dragonflies. Till this example came to the light, we were considering, or the science was considering, the migration of monarch butterflies as the longest insect migration. So they covered around 7,000 to 8,000 kilometers of a distance in their journey. And that involved a single generation, not multiple generation. And but in 2009, this study was published by Dr. Charles Anderson. He's a marine biologist, basically. But he's based in Maldives. And he, out of curiosity, just started taking observations of these dragonflies, which regularly came to Maldives in specific time of the year in October, and they after some days their number was like slowing down. They kind of disappeared from that side, from the islands, and then he wondered and what's happening. So slowly they kept on keeping records and observations from at the same time from different volunteers from across the world, and then they came to know that this is a huge it's a part of huge migratory cycles of it's an intercontinental migration that this species is having. This species, that's why called as globe skimmer. In India, it's called as wandering glider. But if you go to the IUCN's page of it, it will say it's the name also appears as globe skimmer, probably because of this reason. So it's again amazing, very tiny insects, but it takes use of the monsoon currents. So both the southwest monsoon currents that are coming from the western Indian Ocean, and then the northeast monsoon currents, wind currents. So they take use of both these monsoon currents, and that's how they cover this distance. So the observations say that so you might be also seeing large number of pantala around your house or in forests, on grasslands, I think every possible habitat. So this species is a seasonal pool breeder. So whenever these dragonflies or the pantillas are coming from Africa, it will breed over here during the monsoon season in India, June, July onwards till September. And by the end of the October, they will start their return journey back to Africa. So when they are breeding in seasonal pools, so monsoon is, as we all know, is dominant in India for like 3 to 4 months. And during that time, it has to complete its life cycle. So the larval life stage lasts one to two months. And then the adult comes out and joins these other fellow members on the return migration to Africa. And that's how it involves multiple cycle. Around four generation takes part into this the whole cycle. And one more interesting point is it coincides with the migratory routes of some other migratory birds. So like in this case, this is an Amur falcon species, famous example of the migratory bird as we know. So along with the Amur falcon, there are other birds also who cross this same or follow this same route to go towards Africa. So Amur falcons, this is a satellite tagging study done by BirdLife and their partners around the world. So they tagged three Amur falcon birds, and that's how they wanted to see how is the migratory routes. So if you compare this one, so the dragonflies, the route of the dragonflies is shown in this way. So it goes to Maldives, then Seychelles, then other islands near Africa, and then it enters into Horn of Africa, and then it further also goes southwards. And then similarly, it comes or returns to India. Similarly, these birds are also kind of follow the same route. And they assume that these birds, while they are during the migration, they feed on these dragonflies. So again, very interesting association they have. Apart from Amur falcon, there are birds like pied cuckoos, then kestrel, European rollers that show migratory habits. And in case of odonates, along with pantala or along with wandering glider, there are other odonates such as annex, then tramia, bacillaris. They also follow the same migratory routes. They also take part into the migration. But certain species like tramia and all are only seen till Seychelles, like according to the observation of the team, Anderson and all. So that's again one example of the power of citizen science that we have. Because this study involved multiple observations from multiple locations from Africa and India. So, yeah, and we are all aware of the power of citizen science also. We have a beautiful report also that came out, the State of Indian Birds, that was also possible because of the observations by many people. So, yeah, such studies are also important, and we should record as much as possible about the dragonflies and damselflies. Any interesting thing that we see along, and we, you know, collate this information, and maybe, you know, you never know, we'll get some pattern or some interesting result out of it. Yeah. So past couple of years, so I think 5 to 6 years have been really remarkable for Indian odontology, if I may say so. So there are many new records, new species coming up from India. So let's look at some of the examples, some representative stories I would like to tell you. So the northeast part of India, it's a biodiversity hotspot, we all know. It's the 7-8 states, so full of biodiversity and very nice forests. And right now, very much into the part of discussions due to the Italian project. So that's it. So in 2017, Shantanu Joshi and his team came up with this new discovered species called as Planitia paumai. So interesting thing about this species is it is named after the Paumai tribe that resides into the Manipur, that is into the Senapati district. So there are no officially declared protected areas in Senapati district, but these are the community conserved areas or community forest from which this species was described. So that tells us about the importance of the community conservation in our country, and how potential is that part of India. So the other day in the one of the webinars of Dragonfly South Asia virtual meetings, Subramanian sir made it a point that many of the parts of Northeast India are less explored, and rather now they are being explored. So it's possibility that many new species can come up from that area, because till now it was kind of remote, inaccessible. So we can expect more number of species from that area. So this species is very difficult to find and spot in the wild. Likewise, we can expect some more species from the same area. Moving on to the next new species described last year. So this is Cyclomamphus flavoannulatus. Why flavoannulatus is because they have these yellow colored markings on their abdomen. So flavo means it corresponds to the yellow color, and annulatus is the abdominal part. So that's why the name. And till now it is only known from the records are only from Kerala and Goa. So again, this species is associated with the hill streams, the perennial streams of semi-evergreen and moist deciduous forest found in these parts. And this genus is endemic to peninsular India and Sri Lanka. So very difficult species, these gomphids are, but at the same time, very interesting also. So that was about the new species. This is something interesting about the larval behavior of the larval morphology. So our friend Mr. Prasenjit Don is working amazing extensively, and he's doing some amazing work on larval taxonomy and larval behavior right now. So he came up with this publication last year itself. So these are the Calycnemia species. These are specialized in inhabiting the mountain habitats. So this species, the final instar, the instar just before the emergence was not described before, and he did it for the first time. So you can see over here, these the larvae are semi-terrestrial, because the damselfly is kind of laying eggs into the dead plant tissue over here, as you can see. And there is a little bit of water, but that's how the semi-terrestrial these larvae are. He took some observations in this area, the Buxa Tiger Reserve. And very interesting to know that these species are specialized for such kind of habitat, the mountain high elevation habitats. And they lay their eggs on soft moss beds and narrow hill streams. That's what their habitat is. So not very. So it's a kind of different from the other dragonflies or damselflies, where we say that they lay their eggs endophytically and all that. But yeah, so this explains that we still have a long way to go, and we need to. There is a lot more thing to get published. So this is the larva of that species. Very well camouflaged into this its habitat, and very difficult to notice. Yeah. So coming on to the next species, last year also our colleagues and friends Shantanu Joshi and Dattaprasad Sawant came up with this new species called the Sindhudurga marsh dart. So this species is not found in non-protected areas. So the habitat of this species, if you see, is the streams and then it forms a marshland kind of. So there are a lot of new species coming up from non-protected areas as well. So this is a representative of that. And we need to understand that not just protected areas has to be paid attention to, but there is a lot of potential in non-protected areas as well. So basically, it all boils down to the freshwater ecosystem and its conservation. How do we manage them and how do we use them? So this is the only representative, the endemic representative of this genus from the Western Ghats. Till now, it is only known from Kerala, Maharashtra, Sindhudurga part of Maharashtra, and Goa. Okay, so this up till now we talked about mainland species, but there is also a lot more to be discovered in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So as it is, there are islands, there is high endemism on islands. And this is one of those representative species. So before Notostricta nankaura, the ZSI team also discovered another species called the Notostricta nicobarica from Nicobar Islands. And this is named after the central Nicobar parts of that region. So this species inhabits the area, the forest, tropical rainforest, which is dominated by ferns and shrubs. And the female of this species shows different color morphs again. So this one is the male. This one is the female. Not very clear, but it has on the thorax, it has blue kind of color patch. The other color morph shows yellowish orange color patch on its wing. On its thorax. And this is the immature of that species. And very interesting species are there in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, of which we know very little. And these areas had to be paid attention more. Okay. So we have talked till now recently about the diversity of subset of the diversity of that India has, but why to study them at all and why to protect them? Because freshwater ecosystems are important for us, as basic as it can get. So if we want our freshwater system to be secure, we have to study the fauna and the flora associated with it. How, if we are manipulating them, then what are the effects? Those effects are shown by these creatures. It may be the associated fishes or other freshwater invertebrates like mollusks and all. Dragonflies are also important part. The odonates are also important part of the system. So in general, in terms of fauna, if you see, the insects are the predominant group or predominant taxa. So when we talk about insects, we are talking about a lot of biomass, and that is very essential because these are prey base of many other organisms. And they prey upon different organisms also. Like they are like considered as biocontrol agents for mosquitoes. When they are in the larval stage, in the aquatic environment, they feed on the chironous larvae. and they keep a check on mosquito population in the larval stage. When they are adults, they are again the fierce hunters, and they feed on small flies as well as mosquitoes. So again, there also they act as bioindicators. So yeah, they are important to us, and they are also the part of important part of food chain. If when it comes to studying them on a scientific basis or from a scientific point of view, they are excellent models to study many evolutionary mechanisms, like the stream ruby I showed you. So the males of the species or any, so they have these colorful different patterns and colors on their wings. So people are nowadays studying how these color patterns are responsible for in the sexual selection, or based on this the females select them or what, and why these color changes are there, what does that indicate. So all these things people are studying right now. So they are very good model organisms. And then again, prey-predator interaction. So when they are inhabiting a certain microhabitat or habitat, so what are the what is their prey base, and what are the different predators that they have to be cautious about, and what are the different defense mechanisms they have adapted to or they are showing, and then depending on that, what kind of habitat they prefer to live in. So all these mechanisms, so all these scientific studies are very much, you know, these are the good or best suited model organisms for such studies as well. And sometimes it's a sheer joy to watch odonates. That's what I have experienced by myself also. And also these have given rise to many art forms in terms of songs, poems, or paintings like this one over here. So it's a sheer joy watching dragonflies and damselflies. So yeah, again, coming back to the basic point, freshwater ecosystem, important part of freshwater ecosystem. That's why we have to study as well as protect them. And also for the natural history observations like this, when this photographer, Sandesh Kodur, he took this photograph in Southern Western Ghats. So this is a huge fig tree on which the great hornbill was resting, and it was feeding on these dragonflies. Probably these are again Pantella or the wandering glider. So the wandering glider were there to eat the small flies. Those were feeding on the fig fruits, probably the fig wasps or something. And the hornbill was feeding on them. So this is one interesting observation he got when he was on his expedition with, with Nat Geo. So yeah, such natural stream observations are also important. Actually, such observations led us to the observation of underwater position by the Sudagrian female that I showed. The female which was underwater and laying eggs inside the water for at least for 16 minutes. So all those natural history observations are important to know the kind of habitat they live in again, to take note of all the parameters that they want for their breeding, for their living. So yeah, these are important, I guess. I'm coming to the end of the slideshow now. Yeah, a bit about the conservation of freshwater ecosystems. So there are, I'm sure, many more important and other big cases right now to talk about the conservation of freshwater ecosystems, like dam effects, downstream effects of large power projects and all. So this is a small case that I would like to talk about and draw your attention to. This is Damapur Lake in Sindhudurga district of Maharashtra. It's a beautiful lake, 400 to 500 years old lake that is man-made, and this was built basically for irrigation purpose, and still it provides water to surrounding villages called Damapur and then nearby cities, Malvan cities and all that. So recently there is this local group called Simantak. They came forward for the conservation of this, protection of this lake, because there are these new constructions that are coming up over here. It's kind of a walk they want to build, the basically like authorities, government authorities want to build around the lake. And so the beautification part of it, it might destroy or it might disturb the local biodiversity, the flora and fauna, because the lake also inhabits some very rare and endangered aquatic plant species, according to their studies. So so this is the condition right now. They are fighting for the conservation of this lake, and you know, to also aware the local people about that diversity over there. And we conducted last year's Dragonfly South Asia meet over here to understand what is the odonate diversity over here, or what kind of species are there. And not just odonates, but this area is also very rich in terms of the avifauna. Then some reptiles and amphibians also. It's a beautiful place. And there are some other inland wetlands called, this one is full of nice aquatic vegetation, very nice and preferable habitats for damselflies. So such freshwater habitats are there, and they need to be managed wisely. So that's how we in all this, so conservation works in two different levels actually. So sometimes you have to also work on policy level, but before that, basic, you have to have the basic data to present it of what is there and what is not there. So awareness part is also an important part of this process, the whole process of conservation. That we have to make local people aware of what kind of diversity they have in and around their resources, and not just we should not just burden these resources by using them. So awareness is also an important part, and that's what we can do. So that's how we our role comes over here. And there's also my appeal to all of you I hope that today's talk was interesting for you, and when you go next time to the field, you will record more about odonates, and we should record more and get back and discuss about them. And that's how we will go. Yes. So thank you. And you could record your observations and post it on our Facebook group of Dragonfly South Asia, then Odonata of India website also. They are very amazing. Amazing photograph, collection of photographs. Just a second. So yes, you can upload your observations on these two websites. And that's my appeal to all of you, so that we will observe more, we will collect more information, and that's how we grow. So yeah, thank you. Thank you all for your time and listening to me. And now,
yeah,
over to you, David.
Thank you so much, Neha. It was wonderful. It's an amazing talk. And the next.
Thank you.
To add folks and answer those questions.
Your voice is breaking.
I was saying there's a lot of questions are piling up in the chat box, so can you please go through it and answer those?
Okay. Can you please tell about the migration of these species? Rhyophis nemis, variegata. Okay, sorry. I started from in between. Okay. Nowadays very less in dragonfly. What is the reason? I didn't get this question.
Neha, the first question, I think, what is the typical lifespan of dragonflies and damselflies?
Okay, so it ranges from species to species. So like I said, the seasonal pool breeders like Pandala or the wandering glider. The larval life stage lasts about 1 to 2 months. So, and in the wild, the maybe adult survives for a few weeks. So, from few months to a few years. So up to 1 year or so. So that's the range we have. So bigger dragonflies take more time in their larval stage. So from a few months to 1 or 2 years.
Okay. How was the glob skimmer migration tagged and studied? How was it established that 4 generations is involved? What was any telemetry involved?
Okay. So they didn't tag it, but at the similar time they took observations. So the team of Charles Anderson, he collected his volunteers from Africa to all these islands and in India. And along with the monsoon pattern, they counted the period, monsoon period, and that's how they came up with the 4 generation time. Satellite tagging was not done, but a lot of volunteers were there to share their their observations. So they kind of so it's not a this thing very precise, but yeah. From all these observations, they collected this information and they came up with this idea. So, yeah, I think.
Okay. Yeah, is there any migration within the country also, like North India to South India and all?
I have read about the migration in Southern India about these Westerly species, that is stream glory and clear wing forest glories and all those. But I am not familiar with the other migration, I'm sorry, in India.
Okay, which is the best time of the day to look for dragonflies and damselflies?
So if you talk about the season, the post-monsoon season is the best one for overall insects, watching insects. So along with monsoon, you can go to nearby places and start watching. Daytime, if you see during the morning hours, they are most active. And there are some species, as I said, the coral-tailed cloudwing and its indicus, the lesser green emperor. So some of the species are active during the dusk time, the evening time. And they also come to light many of the times. So depends on the species, but most of them are active during the day. So morning hours, 8 onwards.
Okay. Would they continue to grow in size in adult stage after emerging from the final instar larva too?
No, they don't continue to grow. So they don't molt any further. The adult is, it remains its size till the death.
There's a question from Dr. Meera. Do dragonflies or damselflies always live in clean aquatic habitat?
Oh yes, not necessarily. So when we say they are habitat specific, there are some species called as ditch jewel, Brachythemis contaminata, which are pollution tolerant species. And they are also a good example of, they indicate that the presence also indicate that the water might be polluted, because the species itself, the larvae are pollution tolerant. They can also inhabit clean waters, but what happens is generally species, when the species are generally stored, found, like if they are common, they will try to occupy many more and large number of habitats and niches that they have. So yes, the indicators are the ones which requires certain specific specificities, like high humidity or high temperature, then rainfall, and then hills or fast flowing streams or slow flowing streams, medium slow flowing streams. Likewise, so not all of them are associated with the clean water.
Okay, why do certain species migrate? Is it climate condition or food issue problem? From basal questions.
Oh yeah. The root cause of migration, it's not actually very well established, I would say. But yes, climatic conditions, yes. If they are following this monsoon pattern, so they want to breed in those habitats also. And the Anderson team has found actually that when there is a time in India of the monsoon. It doesn't rain over there in Africa. So they are kind of following this pattern. So yes, in a way, climatic conditions and monsoon is the trigger for migration. Basically climatic conditions.
Okay, how do dragonflies fly backwards?
I cannot elaborate on the exact technique, but it again has to do with the flight, the speciality of the flight they have. So because each wing can move independently, so it might be has to do with the air drag also. So they need to calculate also how their speed, if they want to glide or hover at a particular place. And I think it is mostly related with the ability of moving the wings independently. So I don't know the exact physics behind it. I think it has to do, this question has to do more with the physics. But yes, the movement of the wings, basically.
Okay, there's the next two questions. I'll club it from Ashirvad and Vijay is one of. Then, is there any taxonomic book on dragonflies and damselflies? Also, can you please suggest some citizen science portals used records and study Odonate's observation?
So the books, yes. Dragonflies of India, the Lifescapes series of Dr. K. A. Subramaniam, 2009 publication. So that is available on his ResearchGate website. Then there is another book by Dr. Manoj Nair, Dragonflies and Damselflies of Orissa and surrounding states. So that talks about the eastern part of country. So those are the books basically for Indian species that you can follow, where the taxonomic keys are also given and you can start the basic identification with that. And there are a lot of new species coming, so you have to follow the new papers also. So most of the papers are, I think, open access. They are on GOTT, or you can contact the author directly. So books, yes, Dragonflies of India, a Lifescape series, and Manoj Nair's book on Dragonflies of Orissa, Dragonflies and Damselflies of Orissa. So those are the two books. The links for the citizen science portals on which observations can be uploaded, I think, I had given on the last slide. So the links, so I will just call out the names. So Dragonfly South Asia is the Facebook group on which you can upload the observation. Then there is a citizen science portal called as Odonata of India. It's a sister website of I Found Butterflies by NCBS. And there you can upload your observations, basically photos. And then there are also many multiple groups coming on Facebook on which you can upload your observations.
Okay, Neha, thank you. Just to add on to that, there is a book on dragonflies of Delhi and one on dragonflies of Keladev and one on dragonflies of Kerala also.
Oh yeah, sorry. So books in local language, of course, the book by David, that's in Malayalam. So you can start with that also if you want to study the dragonflies of Kerala. And another book by P. Jagannathan also. I think that's in Tamil, right?
Yes, that's also a very good book on dragonflies of Tamil Nadu.
Yes.
Okay, next question. Can this use as a biocontrol agents against mosquitoes? Dr. Meera again.
Maybe. So there was one example, or there was one case. So I think in one of the Southeast Asian countries that they purposefully bred this dragonfly larvae to control the mosquito population, but we certainly don't know how effective that method is. So it will have to be tested by a lot of data and observations on how the effectiveness of it. So we can't just, because once we release the adult dragonflies, so once they are out in the nature, it's out of our control. So a lot many factors will be affecting that, the life of the dragonfly. So purposefully breeding them is, it's not so sure method. So we cannot say surely, very surely about it.
There's a lot of questions are piling up, so I probably will choose 4 or 5 more. And is there a species migration on Rhyothemis variegata?
Yeah. So that was in this chat box. I'm sorry, I'm not able to answer this question. I'm not aware of the species. I mean, I know the species, but not
I don't think any migration.
Okay.
It's a local movement only. Yeah. Okay, what ordinates feed on? Is there any legal protection given for them? They're under wildlife protection act.
Okay, so apart from that, Anisozygoptera, the one I showed at the very first time, the dragon damselfly. Apart from that particular species, Epiophlebia ledlowi, that is found in India, no other ordinate is considered or included in Wildlife Protection Act. So, and also many of the species are data deficient, and we don't have much information about their distribution, their habitat, their threats, as such. So, they're not yet included in the Wildlife Protection Act. But some of them are considered under the Red List threatened species of IUCN. So, we have some near threatened species. Then I think the Phyllonura westermani is vulnerable, if I'm not wrong. So about 8 to 10 species are there under a threatened category of IUCN, but not directly under the protection of Indian law.
Okay. We'll take probably 2-3 more questions. One from Karthika Rajivan. Recently, there had been research on works on using the ordinate diversity and proportion of generalists to specialists as an indication of landscape modification and habitat fragmentation. Can you please explain how this is done?
The question is actually very large. Can you please repeat it?
Recently, there had been research works on using the ordinate diversity and the proportion of generalist to specialist as an indication of landscape modification and habitat fragmentation. I think what she mentioned was the probably the forest species and the other habitat species.
Okay.
Can you explain how this is done?
Okay, so one thing is we have background information, some background information about some specialist species like those associated with like Myristica forest. So those are specialist species that we have. So that's the kind of data when we get when we go and look out for these species. And then the generalist species, as I said before, they will, being generalist, they will occupy more habitats, more niches. So if what I understand by habitat fragmentation is if there is a lot of habitat fragmentation or destruction, then these specialist kind of habitat or the microhabitats get disturbed. And the species which cannot tolerate the habitat or the climate or the abiotic and biotic conditions apart from their specialized one, they will obviously not survive. So I think it is correlated. So depending on the presence and absence of species, you will get to know what kind of effect is there on the forest by forest fragmentation. So yes, if it shows you the positive correlation, and if there are multiple different disturbance factors, that maybe agriculture might be one of them, logging can be one of them, pollution can be one. So if all these factors are there, and if you are finding more generalist species, then it is correlated, right? And so if you have some background data, like if there is a Myristica forest and some particular species was founding there some years before, and due to the destruction of that Myristica patch, if that is not found there in that area, then maybe that's the effect of habitat destruction or fragmentation in that area. So the specialist species will not be able to survive over there. That's how it is done. And I hope this answers your question. So the presence and absence of species, that will tell you about the effect of all these disturbance factors.
Okay, we'll take one more question. That's I think from Facebook Live. Tell us something about cannibalism among dragonflies. Also, please put down your email ID there.
Okay. So yes, cannibalism is very much seen in case of odonids. So because they are voracious feeders and in both life stages, in the aquatic environment at the larval stage and the terrestrial, the adult stage also, both the at both stages it can be seen. And it's not like specific. So if the dragonfly can get hold of another species, like I told you in case of green marsh hawk, it's a medium-sized dragonfly, but I have seen it feeding on the species like common hooptail or something, which are larger than its own body. So basically, these are very ferocious predators. If they can hold off, can get hold of something, then they can either feed on their species of their own, or they can feed on the species other species. Like I've also seen common clubtail feeding on pantala. And all. So in damselflies also it happens. So yes, cannibalism is there. And yes, email ID was there on my first slide. Can I share my screen?
Yes, please.
Okay, if this was the last question, or we can take one more question?
Yeah, that's the last question. There's more questions, but I think they'll write to you if they have.
Okay. Yeah, so this is it visible?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's visible. Okay. Neha, thank you so much for the amazing talk. I mean, it's good to hear, you know. We always love dragonflies, especially, and good to learn all those things. And on behalf of both the NGOs and all the people who attended, we extend our thanks. Thank you all those who are attended. We'll be back tomorrow at the same time with another session. Good night and stay safe.
Thank you all, and thank you for your time.